Hello everyone, I am Manoj Kumar Ekka. You are watching my YouTube channel. Please don't forget to justify my work. So kindly press the like button and subscribe my channel. Today I am here to discuss with you the third part of Act 3, Scene 2, since it is the one of the longest scene. And today we will see that how Nerissa and Graciano are in love at this moment and how they will intervene to Bassanio and Portia and make themselves known that how they are in love. So now let's go to the text. Nerissa: My lord and lady, it is now our time that have stood by and seen our wishes prosper to cry good joy, my lord and lady. So we think we will say both of you good joy, great happiness. Dear lady and lord, accept our wishes. This is what she speaks. Graciano also speaks: My lord Bassanio and my gentle lady, I wish you all the joy and you can wish, for I am sure you can wish none from me. And when your honors mean to solemnize the bargain of your faith, I do beseech you, even at that time I may be married too. So here Graciano already speaks what is going on in his mind and says, My lord Bassanio and my gentle lady, I wish you all the joy that you all can wish to enjoy for yourself forever, because I am sure that you all can wish from me nothing but it, and I wish only your happiness. And when your honors mean to observe formally the bargain of your faith, that is your marriage ceremony to be performed, I do request you to let me be married at that time too. That means same time I want to also marry in that same ceremony where you will be married. And Bassanio says, With all my heart. So thou canst get a wife. Which means Bassanio says, yes, I am very happy. With all my heart I want. You must get to have been married, and provided that you must have a wife, I have no problem. That's what he said. Graciano: I thank your lordship, you have got me one. My eyes, my lord, can look as swift as yours. You saw the mistress, I beheld the maid. You loved, I loved, for intermission. No more pertains to me, my lord, than you. Here Graciano speaks, I thank your lordship, Bassanio. He is very much overjoyed and says, As you have given me a chance to get such a wife, my lord, my eyes to look for a beauty is as swift as your eyes are. As you find out your mistress falling in love, I find out my lady feeling love to her. That is, you are in love and also I am in love. My lord, we are the two who do not want to make delay anymore. That is, as the delay is not a part of life, it is not yours. Then continuation of the line: Your fortune stood upon the casket there, and so did mine too, as the matter falls. For wooing here until I sweat again, and swearing till my very roof was dry with oaths of love, at last, if promise last, I got a promise of this fair one here to have her love, provided that your fortune achieved her mistress. So here frankly he speaks that it was your fortune which was to depend upon your choice of the casket, and it was my fortune which was to depend upon the same thing that was your right choice. So here that if he chooses the right casket, Bassanio, then he was sure that he is going to get married to Nerissa. That's what Russian speaks. Then it was correlated in such way that if you win, I will win. And if you fail to choose, I had been to lose the chance of getting the woman, Nerissa. So I made my love for her with all of my effort and swore my vows until the very roof of my mouth was dried much, because I had made a serial numbers of love. So my mouth went to be dried by telling her promises. But at last I had received a promise of love from this fair lady Nerissa, provided that if your fortune permits you to choose the right casket and to win the mistress Portia, I would be granted by my fortune to receive Nerissa as my wife. And Portia says, is this true, Nerissa? So she asks that whether what she is listening is true, the fact is true or not. And Nerissa says, madam, it is, so you stand pleased with her. So Nerissa says, madam, what you are listening is true, and if you support it and you are pleased with it, we the two can get our marriage. And Bassanio says, and do you, Graciano, mean good faith? Bassanio also asks to Graciano that, Graciano, do you mean to wed this lady, Nerissa, with your good faith? And Graciano says, yes, faith, my lord. And he says, yes, my lord, yes, I want to marry her with my good faith. Then Bassanio says, our feast shall be much honored in your marriage. And he agrees that, yes, our wedding feast shall be much honored in your marriage. And Graciano says, but who comes here? Lorenzo and his infidel. What? And my old Venetian friend Salary. And Bassanio, seeing the entry of Lorenzo, Jessica and Salario, he's quite distressed or shocked and says, but who comes here? Lorenzo and his Jessica, who is an infidel, that is a no-believer Jew. Oh, what is the matter, my old Venetian? What happened? That's what he says. Then there is the entry of Lorenzo, Jessica and Salario. Bassanio says, Lorenzo and Salario, welcome hither. If that the youth of my new interest here have power to bid you welcome by your leave, I bid my very friends and countrymen, sweet Portia, welcome. So Bassanio tells that you are welcome here, Lorenzo and Salario. Come here. I am to welcome you in this place because I have been newly obtained the interest of power. Portia, I want your confession to welcome my good friends and countrymen in your house. Tell me, sweet Portia, can I welcome them? That was Bassanio asks her. Then Portia says, so do I, my lord. They are entirely welcome. So Portia also agrees that he says, yes, yes, you can invite them, my lord. No hesitation, I have no problem. And Lorenzo speaks, I thank your honor for my part, my lord. My purpose was not to have seen you here, but meeting with Salario, by the way, he did entreat me past all saying nay to come with him along. So Lorenzo says, and I thank your honor, it is not for my part, my lord, and my purpose was not to have seen you here. So he had no any plan and not to come here. But why he came? Because it is Salario who told him. One way I had a meeting with him and he requested me to lead him to the place where you are. And so I came because of his request. That's what he says. Salario, I did, my lord, and I have reason for it. Signor Antonio commends him to you, then gives a letter. And it says that it is, yeah, he has done, he agrees, because I have a reason to do it. That's what he says. And our Signor Antonio has sent you a happy greetings, but he has also sent this letter to you. Bassanio, ere I open his letter, I pray you tell me how my good friend doth. That means I Before opening his letter, pray you to tell me how my good friend is now. That's what he asks. Salaryu, not sick, my lord, unless it be in mind, nor well, unless in mind. This letter there will show you his state. Then Bassanio reads the letter. So what Salaryu says is that my lord Bassanio is not sick physically, but he is mentally very much sick and disturbed. He is neither well from the other side, but however the letter from him is in your hand and it would show his entire condition. Graciano, then sir, cheer yon stranger with her welcome. Your hand, Salaryu. What's the news from Venice? How does that royal merchant, good Antonio? I know he will be glad of our success. We are the Jasons. We have won the fleece. Graciano tells Nerissa, be ahead and bid you cheer heart up to the stranger and here to Jessica. She should take care. Then Graciano asks, tell me, what news have you got from Venice? How is that royal merchant, our good hearted Antonio? I'm sure to tell you that he would be glad knowing our success. I think, Salaryu, I and Bassanio both is the Jasons, means the hero of the ancient Greek mythology, to win the golden fleece as we have won these fleeces, named Portia for Bassanio and Nerissa for mine. Salaryu, I would you had won the fleece that he had lost. Yeah, I understand. You have won the fleece, but then he had lost it. Then Portia, there are some shrewd contents in yon same paper that steals the collar from Bassanio's cheek. Some dear friend dead, else nothing in the world could turn so much the constitution of any constant man. What worse and worse? With leave, Bassanio, I am half your son, and I must freely have the half of anything that this same paper brings you. So, seeing the facial expression of Bassanio, Portia understands, and she speaks. Oh, what is the matter? Are there some unpleasant contents in that letter which Bassanio is reading? Because the colors from Bassanio's cheeks are fading gradually. It might have happened some bad incidents that any certain dear friend of his might be dead, because nothing else in the world could turn so much the constitution of any constant-hearted man. A man cannot suddenly change otherwise. What can be it which can turn Bassanio's mental condition from worse to worse? Bassanio, if you do think nothing, I can seek your permission to know about the letter which makes so disgraceful to you. I want to know by the right that I am your would-be wife, and so I am a half of you. In this respect, I have to know freely the half of anything that is of the letter. So please tell me, let me know this. Then see what Bassanio speaks. Oh sweet Portia, here are a few of the unpleasant words that ever mortaled paper. Gentle lady, when I did first impart my love to you, I freely told you all the wealth I had ran in my veins. I was a gentleman. So Bassanio is telling to Portia that, oh my sweet Portia, here are some unpleasant words which are ever marred any paper, that is bottled paper. Oh gentle lady, when I did first impart my love to you, I freely told you that all of my wealth I had spent in futile, yet I was a gentleman. And then I told you true, and yet, dear lady, rating myself at nothing, you shall see how much I was a braggart. When I told you my state was nothing, I should then have told you that I was worse than nothing. So here Bassanio tells his real self what he was.
Oh dear lady, I told you the truth that I had no wealth. But it was the true fact that I was in the extreme crisis of fineness. And yet, I was very much boastful. I was show off I was. But actually, I was a prodigal son. I told you that there was nothing in my estate. And it would have been better that I would have told you that I was nothing. I had nothing. In fact, indeed, it was true. When I decided to reach here for you, I had nothing at all. Then he goes on to say, next line, see. For indeed, I have engaged myself to a dear friend. Engaged my friend to his mere enemy to feed my means. Here is a letter, lady, the paper as the body of my friend, and every word in it a gaping wound, issuing like blood. And therefore I requested earnestly to my dear friend Antonio that as if he gave me money for this, but he had no money at that time, and so he was bound to sign on a dangerous bond of his bitter enemy, Shylock, to manage the money. Thus, he gave me the means, the amount which I required, and I had been able to come here for you. Here is a letter, lady. I am shocked as if the paper has been appeared before me as the body of my friend. Its every word seems to be an open wound from which lifeblood is dropping. The next line then. But is it true, Salario? Have all his ventures failed? What? Not one hit? From Tripolis, from Mexico and England, from Lisbon, Barbary and India? And not one vessel escaped the dreadful torch of merchant marrying rocks? But Salario, is it true? Has all of his ventures failed? That was asking Bassanio. What luck! Not a single ship of his has come back. Oh, none of the ships of his has returned from Tripolis, from Mexico, from England, from Lisbon, from Barbary, and also not even from India. Has not one vessel escaped being wrecked against the dread rock, which oftenly mars the ships and throws the honors in perils? So this is what question Bassanio is asking. Salario speaks, not one, my lord. Besides, it should appear that if he had the present money to discharge the Jew, he would not take it. So Salario confirms that not even one ship has come back. Be careful to listen to me, my lord. It is clear that if Antonio cannot manage money at once to repay the debt, the Jew would not receive money after being over the scheduled time. The next line, never did I know a creature that did bear the shape of man, so keen and greedy to confound a man. So Salario says that, in fact, I do never see such a creature who has borne the shape of man, but who is so much interested and greedy to confound, to ruin the other one. See the next line. He pies the Duke at morning and at night, and doth impeach the freedom of the state. If they deny him justice, 20 merchants, the Duke himself, and the magnificos of greatest port have all persuaded with him, but none can drive him from the envious plea of forfeitures of justice and his bond. So what Salario says that now that Jew Shylock is running at morning and at night to apply the Duke, and he is impeaching the Duke for the freedom of the city, that if the court denies him to give him the justice, the city's position in the eye of the other world nations would be perished. That will be over. Other nations will not follow. My lord Bassanio, the Duke himself, 20 merchants of Venice, and the magnificos of the greatest port have tried to make him understand, tried to solve this matter, and requested him to return back from his vile, inhuman demand, so cruel demand. But dear Bassanio, none can change him from the envious demand. So envy, no, Shylock is on the bond. He wants that bond by all means. But the Jew is rigid for justice because he is ready to produce his bond in the court and somehow take the revenge against Antonio. Jessica speaks because she is his daughter and says, "When I was with him, I have heard him swear to Tubal and to Chos, his countrymen, that he would rather have Antonio's flesh than 20 times the value of the sum that he did owe him. And I know, my lord, if law, authority, and power deny not, it will go hard with poor Antonio." So Jessica, as she knows her father how he is, and that's what she said, "Listen to me, when I was with him, I have heard him swear an oath to Tubal and to Chos, his fellow countrymen, that he would take surely Antonio's flesh rather than the 20 time multiplication of the value of his given loan that Antonio took. Oh my lord, I know well my father. He must do it, and he will. I tell you, my lord, if the law, the authority, and the power do not deny his demand, then it will be very hard on Antonio." That's what she says. Portia speaks, "Is it your dear friend that is thus in trouble, Bassanio? The dearest friend to me, the kindest man, the best conditioned and unwearied spirit in doing courtesies, and one in whom the ancient Roman honor more appears than any that draws breath in Italy." So Portia asked whether it was Bassanio's dearest friend who is in trouble, and Bassanio says, "Yeah, really, Portia, Antonio is my dearest friend and the kindest man in the world. I think, in fact, he is the best natured and untired man in doing courtesies. I think he is that only one person who has the heart to exhibit the old Roman honor more than anyone who is to draw his breath in Italy now." Then Portia asks, "What sum owes he, the Jew, Bassanio? For me, 3,000 ducats." So Bassanio tells how much money he had taken. Then Portia, "What, no more? Pay him 6,000 and deface the bond. Double 6,000 and then treble that, before a friend of this description shall lose a hair through Bassanio's fault." So Portia says that it is only 3,000 ducats, not more than that. So pay him 6,000 and cancel the bond, or double the 6,000 and then you can treble it, and you would pay him the sum, and you must arrive before your friend in Venice, because I have been known to you about his kindness. Go and try to rescue him, and as if you shall not lose him in a single hair cap of your fault, as he did it only for you." Then she goes on to say, "First go with me to church and call me wife, and then away to Venice to your friend. For never shall you lie by Portia's side with an unquiet soul. You shall have gold to pay the petty debt 20 times over. When it is paid, bring your two friends along. My maid Nerissa and myself, meantime, will live as maids and widows. Come away, for you shall hence upon your wedding day. Bid your friends welcome, show a merry cheer. Since you are dear bought, I will love you dear. But let me hear the letter of your friend." So she says that, "Listen to me first. Let's go to the church and call me your wife to marry me. Then you shall go straight to Venice to your friend. But you shall never lie by my side. in my bed because it must distract your mind. I tell you shall go to pay the petty debt 20 times over. When the debt would be paid over, you shall bring your true friend here. However, I and my attendant Nerissa, on the meantime, would have to live as spinsters and widows. Come, we go to the church for our marriage, because it would be good day for you to go away to Venice for your best friend. Yes, I bid your friends welcome, and I expect you must show a cheerful face now, as your friend has paid for you so dearly, and for which you have been able to reach here, and I also have been fortunate to win you as my husband. I confess I will love you dearly, but let me hear what the contents of the letter sent by your friend. That's what she says. Then Bassanio reads the letter. Sweet Bassanio, my ships have all miscarried. My creditors grow cruel. My estate is very low. My bond to the Jew is forfeit. And since in paying it, it is impossible I should live, all debts are clear between you and I. If I might but see you at my death, notwithstanding, use your pleasure. If your love do not persuade you to come, let not my letter. So, see the letter what it says. That sweet Bassanio, my ships all are miscarried, and my creditors showing their cruel nature to return back their money. And at this time, in this situation, my condition is very low. So the bond to the Jew which I signed has been forfeited, and this is why I have to pay my penalty to him. And what is that penalty? Death. All the debts would be cleared between you and I, if I only may see you at the time of my death. However, it would be your pleasure, and if you are to feel your love to your old friend, you can come to meet at my death, or let no attention pay to my letter. So Antonio has left everything to the choice of Bassanio, but then he has clearly written it on the letter. Listening to the heart-touching note of Antonio, you see what Portia says. Oh love, dispatch all business and be gone. Bassanio, since I have your good leave to go away, I will make haste. But till I come again, no bed shall ever be guilty of my stay, no rest be interposer twixt us twain. So, you see what Portia says, that Bassanio, my dear, no more to wait. Go fast. It is a very pathetic situation. And Bassanio says that as I have received your good permission to start my journey to Venice, I must make haste as soon as I can reach there. But I come back again. Even I will take no bed with you in such moment, and I do not want at all to stay on the bed and to make a guilty from my sight. And I do want no rest to waste the time, and I will not take rest as long as I cannot meet you again. And that's how he departs. So my dear friends, here we end the third part of Act 3, Scene 2. I hope you have understood. It has been very long scene. I have tried my best. So see you in the next video of mine, that is Act 3, Scene 3. Till then, thank you very much. God bless you.